So, hi everyone, thanks a lot for coming both to the fair and to listen to this presentation about Supercell. This presentation will be focused on a little bit on our background, but mostly on how our company is structured, how that structure affects the way that we work, and how that way that we work affects the sort of people that we're interested in hiring. If we have time, I'll also show a short video at the end, which is only about 3 minutes long, where we interview people who work at Supercell but who are not Finnish about what they think about Finnish people and working with Finns, which I hope you'll find helpful. But let's start with just a little bit of history and a tiny bit of history about myself. My name is Chris. I came here with my colleague Malla, who's sitting over there. We both work in the recruitment team at Supercell. I've been at Supercell for 4.5 years now. Before I was a recruiter, I worked in the Clash of Clans player support team. And before Supercell, I did completely different work. So I kind of jumped in to the games industry at a slightly older age. I'm 37, I have two kids and a dog, but I've been a video game player enthusiast since the age of 7, when I bought my first Nintendo Entertainment System. It's wonderful to be part of this industry. And Supercell's story started a bit later than mine. It started in 2010 when the company was founded. And the first office was in Espoo, which is just west of Helsinki. It's the suburban area, the company had one room where that was the whole office. So people were just sat towards the walls, working on our very early projects. And a very famous object is this coffee maker, because that's really the only benefit that the company had at the time, coffee maker. And the machine is still around somewhere. Supercell started by doing flash-based games for desktop, web, and Facebook. In 2010, it wasn't obvious at all that the touchscreen was going to be a gaming platform. So that's where we started. We made a game called Gunshine, among some others, that was launched and played by 200,000 players, but it wasn't big enough. The company was founded by people who had been part of Digital Chocolate, so they already had experience of running a company and they had some success with Digital Chocolate, but they wanted to do something much bigger. So the decision was made to pivot. That is, forget about Facebook, forget about web-based games or desktop web-based games. They ordered a few iPads to the office and started fooling around with those and thought that, okay, this could really be a big thing. And that's when things really started changing for Supercell. And quickly, from this tiny office with around a dozen employees, we have, over the past 7-8 years, grown to a company with 240 plus people. We now have over 30 nationalities and 5 offices. Helsinki is by far the biggest office. 2/3 of the company is based there. That's where we have all the game development. That's where we have the other core functions like finance, like administration. The CEO and COO sit with us there. And around 2/3 of the people who work in Helsinki are expats. So they come from other countries. The other offices are focused on marketing. So San Francisco is the headquarter for marketing, and then we have local marketing offices in Shanghai, so on, Tokyo. You may ask, okay, I understand Helsinki, and I kind of understand San Francisco, but why do you need 3 offices in East Asia? It's because Supercell wants to be a global company. We want to reach all gaming audiences everywhere. And maybe you know that especially the East Asian players are really hard to convince. especially when you're from the West, you come with a Western video game, and they think, no, we don't want any Western games. The Koreans make the best games, is what they say in Korea. And the Japanese think, no, I don't want to play foreign games, I want Japanese games. And the same is very much true in China in many cases. But there are exceptions, like StarCraft made it big in Korea. Some other Western games, CS, for instance, has been quite popular in China. So we want to challenge the status quo and be big in East Asia too. So that's why we have the local offices there. They're quite small though. But yeah, let's move on a little bit. Games that we have published globally are these four. So we have Heyday and Clash of Clans that came out in 2012, and then a couple of years later, Blue Beach was launched, and then our most recent game is Clash Royale. How many of you have played at least one of these games? How many of you are currently actively playing a Supercell game? Maybe we need an office in St. Petersburg too. Something that's quite typical for Supercell, or something that exemplifies how we work, is that we want to polish our games and make them as good as possible before we release them globally. We don't want to make a product that we're not 100% proud of and then just put it out in the market and hope that it does well. We want to be convinced that this is a really good thing. So when we develop a game, we play a prototype internally within the company. We give feedback to the dev team. We do this back and forth a few times. The development team makes a few improvements, and then when we feel good about a game, we publish it in a beta launch. And for us, that means putting a game out, usually on the Canadian App Store. So if you have a Canadian App Store account, you can download these soft launched games. And a few examples of the games that we have soft launched are Spooky Pop, Smash Land, and currently Brawl Stars. Spooky Pop didn't make it. We weren't happy with the feedback that we got from the Canadian and Australian markets. The same happened with Smash Land, so we also killed that game. Brawl Stars is really good fun, and this is something that we're still now in the process of checking how it's gonna how it's doing in Canada. Brawl Stars is quite a different game from what we've done so far. It's a 3v3 shooting game, a bit like a type of gameplay experience that you'd normally find on a console or a PC that we're now trying to do on mobile. But to get these four big hits, we've killed a lot of games, and these are just the games that have made it to beta stage, and then we have tens of games that have been killed even before getting this far. And focusing on quality is what we believe has been the key to achieving this sort of success, that we reached the milestone of having over 100 million plays about games every single day. And this is an achievement that we're very proud of, and it's really great to see how our games have been embraced by such a huge portion of the world's population in so many different countries. When we released this piece of news, there was one country that still wasn't playing any of our games, and that was the island nation of Vanuatu in the Pacific. But after they heard about this, they started playing our games too, so now Vanuatu is playing as well. You might ask, okay, so is it really that easy? You focus on quality and then, hey, you get to 100 million players per day. Of course not. There's more to it. And what is another key aspect to how Supercell operates is the company structure. So a very typical company model would look like this. If you go to most corporations, you have the CEO at the top, and then you have the leadership group. So you have the CFO, the COO, CMO, whatever here. They have their own directors, and the directors have their own managers, and the managers have their own subordinates. So you have lots of reporting layers, and you have a fairly top-heavy structure. This works well, especially in, say, the military, or if you have a big company, especially if it's a company that doesn't rely so much on creativity. If you need to run a big oil business and your business is really just to pump out oil and refine it, then sure, this model's probably going to do really well. But when you're in an industry like games, where you need creativity, where a lot of things happen all the time, the market changes, the technology changes, there has to be much more agility, and that's where all of this is almost a problem, because it moves so slowly. So this is a simplified version of how Supercell operates. The ideas in the traditional model come very much from the top, or maybe somebody down here has an idea, but then it has to go through the entire chain to the CEO, and the CEO has to accept or not accept the idea, and then it maybe goes down. And maybe the CEO says it was my idea, even though it wasn't. We want to give everybody in our teams freedom to be creative. So if you are, let's say this is one of our game development teams, so two of these are programmers, another two are artists, then we have some community managers. We depend on everybody out of those people to contribute to the game development process. If you have an idea, a thought about what you think your game should be, then you have the responsibility to speak out and say that this is what I think, this is what I think we should do. And then the game, as the team, as a unit, discusses these ideas and thinks, okay, is this a good idea? Is this something we want to execute? And if it's a yes, then they do it. If it's a no, then they don't. And the leads, so to speak, we have game leads, or we have leads for each unit at Supercell. They do have formal authority over the team, but really their job is not to be there to say to the team, you need to do this so that we're successful. Their job is more like asking, what do you need to be successful? How can I help you to be successful? And this is also what the CEO does for the rest of the company. Well, how can I, as a CEO, make sure that you have what you need to make the great games that you do? And this boils down to our key phrase. We believe that the best teams make the best games. The teams need to be a good combination of the right skills, the right people, people who have unique talents, but also who have social skills and who have the courage and those personal qualities that you need to speak up and to be creative and participate in the whole creation of the game. And yeah, what does a best team mean then? Well, the things that we put down as very important pointers are independence and responsibility. If you want to join Supercell, as I said, you have the responsibility to speak up and say what you think about a game. But you also have the independence to do something. If you have a great idea, just present it. Show it to the rest of the company. Also, what we do needs to be really good, so we focus on quality. And of course, quality is constantly shifting. You need to be better and better and better, which means we have to learn and learn and learn. So that's why learning is also important. And we focus on impact. So it doesn't matter if you say, oh, I've been working on this code for 150 hours. If you can do the same code in 5 hours or 15 hours, that's much better. We don't want to celebrate anybody just doing formal things or working for certain hours. We want to celebrate the actual impact and the achievements and work smart, because we want to stay small as a company. As I showed you, we have 240 people. Sounds big maybe, but at the same time, it's quite a small company considering how big our games are. And so all the teams need to be very clever about how they work. We're transparent, so people are very open about what's happening in the company. And this strengthens people's faith also in the company. And we take very good care of people's overall well-being by having a good work-life balance, because our people at the company are the most important resource we have, so we really don't want to take any risks in that regard. People work hard, but they play hard. And people sometimes do long hours, but then when they rest 100%. And this really boils down to having really great people at the company. So you, I mean, yeah, we have benefits like a nice fridge full of snacks and treats and stuff, which is always nice, but at some point you're going to get used to it. It's not going to feel special anymore, and it just becomes the new normal for you. But when you're surrounded by really great people who are superb at what they do professionally, but we're also very nice people, I think that's what makes a work environment really great. And I think Supercell has been very good at accomplishing this. And just a few, I'll give you one example of independence at Supercell in the making. So Clash Royale's community manager just had this, he was thinking, what can we do to reach out to the player base better? And he thought, how about doing a podcast? It could be called Radio Royale. And then he just went to the Clash Royale development team and asked them, hey, I have this idea, what do you think? They thought it was a good idea. He got Sip, who's a graphic artist, and Bangs and Dave, who are programmers, to sit down and record Radio Royale every now and then. And this is how it happened. There wasn't a formal request process to the CEO or whatever. It was just something that somebody wanted to do, and then it was turned into reality. The focus that these guys have to have is to make sure that the quality is really good. So yeah, that's the responsibility part of being independent, that you have to make sure that you're doing something really, really good.